morning, ladies and gentlemen. Let me begin by first thanking the organizers of this breakfast meeting, Mr. Atu Afful, the MD of Graphic Business, and the MD of Stanbic Bank, Mr. Alassane Adani. Also to thank the MDs of the banks that have been able to join us this morning, and to thank the organizers again for the opportunity to speak on this topic, achieving a sustainable exchange rate and the options. I believe you would all agree with me that this is a topic that is timely, coming at a time that we have successfully emerged out of a recent bout of volatility in our exchange rate, which has generated a lot of debate domestically as well as externally. It is my expectation that my brief remarks and subsequent discussions will help shape the narrative on the currency and exchange rate management in the context of a small, open, commodity-dependent economy that has adopted a flexible exchange rate regime to underpin the conduct of monetary policy. I think this is an important point to make. First, to understand that we have different exchange rate regimes. You can choose to have a fixed exchange rate or, to the extreme, the currency board type of exchange rate regime with rigid fiscal rules. And our neighbors have it, the safer zone, they have the currency board arrangement. They have very rigid fiscal rules, which means that there's very little that you could use even monetary policy or fiscal policy to do. I think that the judgment is out in terms of the growth performance of countries that have adopted the very rigid exchange rate arrangements, such as our neighbors. And we see it in terms of the arrears that are created in that system. One of the reasons why we don't have a flow of goods and services within our sub-region is because some of these people who man our borders are not being paid. They are fiscal rules. That means that the budget probably doesn't have the financing. It shows up in people not being paid. And therefore, obviously, we have to close an eye to some of the things that happens across the borders. So those are some of the difficulties with having that type of exchange rate regime. We have chosen a flexible exchange rate regime in Ghana. We think that it has served us well. It has helped us in terms of the growth performance that we have all seen in the last few years or so. So yes, as a country, that is the exchange rate that we have adopted. I think we need to understand that the exchange rate is only a price. And within that context, as with all prices of goods and services, the exchange rate will respond to the dynamics of the economy and will also be subject to the dynamics of demand and supply. Looking at the history, the flexible exchange rate regime has served Ghana well, given the structural characteristics of our economy. I'm sure those of you of the school of thought that pegging the cedi to one of the major currencies to achieve stability might sound appealing, but as I said earlier on, in our view, this has not been very favorable for the growth experience of those countries that have experimented with fixed exchange rate regimes. As we all know, Ghana's economy is import dependent, and therefore the existence of persistent foreign exchange demand pressures by importers. I see that Guta is represented on the panel, and we would hear from them where their issues come from. In addition to these huge demand pressures coming from imports, we also have the issue of repatriation of profits and dividends to foreign-owned companies, which also represent a significant outflow of resources out of our services and income accounts, another source of pressure on the local currency. These developments explain why, even in the context of 2 years of trade surpluses, which have not translated into current account surpluses, we have seen some bouts of exchange rate depreciation. I think I need to emphasize this point, that one of the things that we have seen over the last 2 years is the improvement in oil export earnings for Ghana. So we have moved away from a situation where Ghana always recorded a trade deficit to becoming a country that is recording a trade surplus on the basis of oil exports. But when you move from the trade account and you get into the current account, you see that we end up with a current account deficit. And the reason for the persistent decline in the value of the currency. Obviously, we need to improve the local content in some of our leading sectors, such as the oil sector, such as the gold mining sector, in order to improve the performance in the income and services account. The strong policy reforms introduced in the last 24 months, fiscal consolidation, a complementary monetary policy stance, financial sector reforms, in our view, are yielding the results. And these are the issues of the fundamentals of our economy. We have seen it from the improvement in growth, which has improved from a low of 3.6% in 2016. We have seen it in terms of the drop in the inflation rate from over 15.6% to single digits. We have seen it in the halving of the fiscal deficit, and then also through the very strong external payments position. All of these, in terms of the export performance over this period, has also meant that we were able to build reserves to the tune of $7.6 billion in 2017, representing 4.4 months of import cover. Lately, our reserves have moved to $9.9 billion, representing 5.1 months of import cover, following the recent sovereign bond issuance. All of these reflect the attraction of the positive turnaround in the Ghanaian economy to foreign investors who have been contributing to finance the deficits. The growing exposure to foreign investors also means that the country becomes susceptible to movements in global sentiments. And as you know, this was seen in the performance of the CDI. If you look at the performance in 2018, the very significant improvements in the fundamentals, what we call the macro fundamentals, did impact on the value of the CDI, with a strong performance in 2018, till the week beginning the 21st of May 2018, where the combination of factors, including the U.S. monetary policy, globalization, the sharp, the stronger U.S. dollar, impacted adversely on emerging and frontier market economies. This resulted in portfolio reversals from emerging markets to take advantage of higher yields in the U.S. In Ghana, we saw this through the increased coupon repatriation, which exerted additional pressure on the local currency. At the end of October 2018, the currency had depreciated by 7.8%. At the start of 2019, the CDI's volatility reflected the seasonal foreign exchange pressures, fueled by the importers and corporates, weakened investor sentiments, concerned about the economic outlook for Ghana as we were on the verge of exiting the IMF program. All of this triggered some outflows, putting additional pressure on the CDI, as well as some repatriation of coupons by non-resident investors, which contrasted with the past trends of reinvestment of coupon proceeds. Thirdly, as part of the objective to build loss reserves in 2018, the Bank of Ghana decided to work to improve its net international reserve levels to the level at the end of 2018. This required the bank's limited presence in the market. All of these, of course, added to pressures on the market and led to a depreciation of the cedi by 8% as of March 2019, compared with 0.02% in the same period of last year. I think you would all have recently seen the recovery that the currency has experienced, appreciating from the peak of 5.9 Ghana cedis to the dollar to current levels, which I think are around 5.1 cedis to the US dollar, reflecting the successful reversal of sentiments on the economic outlook, the successful completion of the IMF ECF program, which has served to provide an endorsement of macroeconomic policy, and the subsequent release of the last tranche of foreign exchange resources associated with the completion of the program, as well as the positive news which was associated with the 3 billion euro bond inflows, which has improved the country's reserve buffers. In addition, S&P Global Ratings affirmed its BB long and short-term foreign and local currency sovereign credit ratings on Ghana with a stable outlook. The affirmation of the issues was attributed to Ghana's relatively strong growth prospects, driven in large part by increased oil production, which is expected to support sound fiscal policy management and help deliver a favorable macroeconomic outlook. On these positive accounts, the broad expectation is for a further improvement in the value of the cedi over the medium term. I think all that I've tried to say, to break it down, and I think the panel will break it down further, hopefully, in the next section, is that the cedi is a price. It reflects the supply and the demand. As you all know, on the demand side, we have the importers. On the supply side, you have the exporters. And to the extent that we have more importers than we are supplying, broadly speaking, you see that the currency would tend to depreciate. That's the basic fundamental. And I think this is the point that the president was making, that we need to change the narrative on the currency. We need to change the narrative on the currency, because so long as we remain import dependent, we would have that bias, the bias of the currency losing its value over time. But in addition to that, there are also the macroeconomic factors which come into play. The way you run your fiscal policy, the way you run your monetary policy, all of these variables also have an impact on the behavior of the exchange rate. So, for example, you have non-resident investors in your market that are looking at the return on your domestic bonds. If they see that the interest or yields on other markets are more attractive, they will take their investments out, and the impact of that sort of exit from your bond market would reflect in the value of your cedi over time. So we have to work. We have to work on all fronts. We have to work to improve our export earnings. We have to work to improve local content in the mining sector, in the budget, away from non-residents, and also away from the sovereign bond financing. I see the article in the Graphic Business this morning on Ghana mortgaging its future to save the cedi, which I think it's an important point, but we need to refocus the issue more on the budget, because the sovereign bond issuances were done to finance the budget. And the impact on the exchange rate and the balance of payments, I think, is a secondary matter. And therefore, the question to ask is, what are the use of proceeds from these sovereign bond issuances? And how do you, what has the government done in terms of utilizing these resources to finance projects that would improve the capacity to export for the country? This is where the question is, rather than just using sovereign bond financing for current expenditures, you want to see that such resources are directed at, you know, projects that would have, you know, major important implications for the capacity to export, for example. So that, I think, would be one of the important recommendations that should come out of a discussion of this nature at this forum. Obviously, the need to improve the business environment in terms of the ease of doing business would also matter. Look, re-examining our laws to improve business environment, making sure that we have business-friendly regulations which would make it easy to move goods across the country, looking at our retention agreements, in the gold and oil sectors, promoting non-traditional exports, etc., etc. So really, this is really to provide you a teaser into some of the issues that I think the panel will be delving deeper into. So at this point, I believe that these pointers would help to shape the discussions that would follow so that we can all understand the factors that drive our exchange rate and proffer solutions that will lead us to a more stable situation.